Hi guys, welcome back to the DxO PhotoLab 7 series. This video is quite a short video and it's an introduction to the concept of local adjustments in PhotoLab 7. Now, very quickly, what a local adjustment is, it allows the photographer to focus on changing the values of actual areas of the image. So this is totally different from a generalized alteration where you might alter the exposure and the whole picture gets brighter. This is just focusing on tiny little bits, and this is where the creativity happens. This is what puts you in charge of your picture. So let's get into that. I thought it'd be useful to reset the context of this local adjustments demo. So let's have a look at general adjustments first. Now, the most generalized adjustment of all is exposure in the basic panel, in the light panel. So ramp the exposure up, the whole picture gets lighter. Take it down, the whole picture gets darker. There's no sense of selective adjustments with exposure. It's either up, down. Every pixel is affected. If we look to tones, we can see that we can actually reduce the sky by dropping the highlights. We can open up the blacks a little, and so on. So this is a selective tone, but it is tone-based. Now, if I want to change, for example, this rock here, and make this the focus of attention, I'm going to need to make it brighter than any of the other areas around here. And I can't do that with selective tone or with exposure or with contrast. That simply isn't going to happen. And this is the problem that local adjustments are built to resolve. So we open the local adjustments panel, and I'm just going to go through them one by one, pointing out some of the features. Each one of these local adjustments is going to have its own video in which we will go into all of the details surrounding them. The takeaway from here is that you can add local adjustments, you can group them, you can mix them together, you can partially erase the mask created by local adjustments. So these are very much about unleashing your creativity on the image. It's here that you really put your mark on the picture. So talking about the rock, let's have a go at changing that. So we put a control point on it. Now what's happening here is that we've sampled the pixels at the center of the control point. This uses the NIC U-point technology under the covers. And it will apply the mask to pixels that match the characteristics, the tonal and color characteristics of those pixels under the center. So you can see the mask getting slightly weaker as the rocks get slightly lighter. But what we'll want to do here is to pull this in, because I really don't want this to spill out onto neighboring rocks as so far as is possible. This looks like a reasonable selection. So let's have a look and see what happens when we drop the exposure here. Okay, you can see the rock is getting darker. Let's have a look and see what happens as we raise it. Okay, so now this rock is matching, if not slightly lighter than the area down here, and draws your eye slightly further into the picture. And this is what we really wanted to achieve with this. We can soften the effect of the control point, or of this one, by changing the opacity. It makes it a little more subtle. And we can play with the mask itself by changing the mask selectivity parameters. So let's have a look and see how that might work. If we put show masks on, let's drop the luminance. And what we're saying here to the mask intelligence, if you like, is we know you've sampled these pixels, but don't be so sensitive about the luminance. Make that more of a vague thing. If we and so you can see that the mask is spread wider within the circle immediately. Take this up to the other end, 100%, and we've got a much tighter selection here. And don't forget, any change you make will be applied to the red pixels here. Chroma is about colour. So again, if we take the, if we say to it, don't be so sensitive about colour, we see less of a problem here, less of a adjustment here, because actually this area is pretty much all on the brown scale. And so taking that up, yes, you'll see a small difference, but it's not enough to make any real creative decisions around. So as far as this particular mask goes, we're really looking at Luma to make that mask tighter or looser. And there's obviously a lot of combinations here. You've got three moving parts on any one mask. Okay, moving on. Let's have a look at control lines. And we'll make a new mask and we'll draw that down from the top. And you can see that this is, well, you may not be able to see it, but I'll, the point where I, which I use to position the mask is applying 100% of the filter. If I drag it down the page, 100% is applied behind this point, so it's always good to be aware of. The other feature of this mask is the dropper, which if I clear it out from behind the pointer here, if I apply this to a light part of the sky, it will pretty much restrict this mask to those luminance values. Just to prove that point, if I take it into the rock here, you're going to get a completely different mask in a second, okay? So you see here, it's only applying to the much darker part of the sky now. So let's take this back. The piece at the bottom is about increasing the gradient. So it's zero pixels are affected by the mask at this line. 100% there, and if I want to make a more abrupt one, then I can simply take that up there. Okay, so the control line is a specialized kind of control point, but it is also a turbocharged gradient filter. Let's have a look at the gradient filter. We'll take it from the corner here. Okay, and what you will notice immediately is that you can take the gradient from outside of the picture, and this is actually quite powerful. It doesn't look particularly pleasant, but it is quite powerful because it's a gradient, you've got a much more finely graded area here, and that's the area that we want to work on. And what I'm going to do is I'm just going to take this area down a little bit, so that we can go back to the control point and we can pull that up a little bit. And I've probably done too much there, but let's just ease that back a tad. Okay. Turn these masks off. And you can see behind the dropper there, if I move that control line, that rock is now marginally brighter than the area here. If we would make it brighter still, we'll start to draw the eye to this rock rather than here. And that was the point I was trying to make. The next one we're going to have a look at is Luminosity Mask. And this is only available, remember, if you have an install of Film Pack 7. Now, what the Luminosity Mask does is it samples the pixels at the point that I drop the dropper, and it uses those to match the mask to pixels elsewhere in the image. Okay, so, and it's based, as you might have guessed, on luminosity or brightness. So click the plus for a new one. And what we'll do is, let's have a look what happens if we click here. This is the middle distance. Okay, so the first thing you'll notice is that we haven't picked the sky because the sky is radically different, and we haven't picked a lot of the land because the land is radically different in a different direction. It's darker. Now, on the second row here, we see the bounds of the areas that have been selected for the luminosity mask. So we can decrease the lightness here by dragging that in, and you'll see immediately that it's let go of a lot of the sky and some of the areas down here. But there are other ways to skin this cat. So let's take that back. If we drag this in, we can see that we're letting go of a lot of the darker areas. All right, take that back. You can narrow the scope by dragging these two together, or you can completely reset this by choosing a gray point on the scale that goes from black to white, or near white, near black to near white. Okay, we'll stick with this representation because what I want to show you is simply this using the eraser tool. Okay, now with the eraser tool, you have to have an active local adjustment, and it applies it just to the active local adjustment. So if my intention is to manipulate that middle ground, here's my eraser. Now I'm going to increase the flow right up to 100% here, because I'm just going to make a broad brush stroke to get rid of all of the pixels that we don't want to affect. Okay, and let's take it right across here. You can see it's just brushing this out. Okay, that's pretty much removed it from all the critical areas. Okay, and now we can change the values on this middle ground. We can make them a little bit brighter, and we increase that sense of haze over the middle ground. I quite like that personally. So I've shown you a very quick way here to use luminosity masks to select areas of the picture. Okay, we've got two more types of local adjustments, the brush and the auto mask. Now, I'm going to demonstrate the brush first because that will certainly help you to appreciate the auto mask when we get there. So, clicking on the brush icon, remember to hit the plus so that it is not associated with any of the other filters. And what I'm going to try to do here is to brush over the edge of this hill here with a view to just lifting that up a little bit at the top. Now, I can change the size of my brush. I can change the feather of my brush. So the feather basically determines the size of the innermost red pixels. So if I feather it here, what we're seeing is that the effect of the brush will fall off towards the edges, and that's very useful for getting a sort of softer, more integrated brush. Flow, if you can imagine here, 100% flow, one brush stroke will apply the entire effect of the brush. 50% flow, it's going to take two brush strokes to apply the entire effect of the brush. So if I set my brush to, let's just have a look and see where we are with that previous one. If I set my brush to that, then I can continue brushing, and you can see it because I've got my flow set to 60%, it's taking two strokes to apply this brush to the area, do you see? And this is a great way of getting a little bit more subtlety into your corrections. Opacity, this one affects the brush itself as you're putting it on. This one affects the effect of the mask. So I can take that one down, okay? So that gives you effectively the brush. Now the shortcoming in the brush is this. If I raise this exposure up, you'll see this much more vividly. It's the ghosting that appears around the edge. You cannot get satisfactorily a really tight outline. So imagine if this was a building against the sky with a couple of TV aerials on top. Tricky things to brush, and it really is not worth trying to persist with the brush under those circumstances. Now let me delete this brush, and we'll replace it with an entirely different mask. This is called the AutoMask. And what the AutoMask is really good at is singling out areas where there's high contrast. So if we brush it over here, and we push that exposure up again. Okay, I've ramped this up much higher than I normally would, but it's to make a point. And the point is that there is no shadowing over there. So we've got a nice high contrast area. We're able to select the jagged edge with the greatest of ease with one brush stroke. And AutoMask is really useful for that type of adjustment. Okay, so that concludes the demonstrations of the local adjustments. Remember that each one of these will have its own video. We've already released the control point and control line videos. This week we'll be releasing the control point video, and then there'll be another couple of videos to clear up on the other masks. But the things that you're going to learn in those next videos are much more about how to use these masks in combination, how to use simple masks creatively to get complicated effects, and we'll be using it on perhaps a better picture than this that we can really make a difference to. So I look forward to seeing you in the next video.